And we are live. Hello everyone. Carlos here, and another installment of my live stream. Today we're going to talk about the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists, or in other words, the 2017 Doomsday Clock Statement. What is it? The Doomsday Clock Statement. Well, it's basically counts down to how far we are to the end of the world as we know it. Lyrics from a song. The bulletin was founded in 1945 by the Manhattan Project scientists who could not remain aloof to the consequences of their work, right? They basically evaluate how far are we to the end of the world, as I said, through many factors. Up until 10 years ago, 20 years ago, it was a basically a nuclear war. The Bulletin is an independent non-profit organization with the international network of board members and experts who assess scientific advancements that involve both benefits and risks to humanity, with a goal of influencing public policy to protect our planet and all its inhabitants. It's a noble goal. I fully back it up and behind it, yes. But this year's statement was I'm a bit worried about the wording and about the how they achieved it. I have this statement here and I will share it so everyone in the shit, wrong screen. Let's see, I'll put this back down. Sometimes I'm not very prepared and I'm doing the wrong stuff. One sec. Sorry about the unpreparedness, people. I'm a complete idiot at this. But it's basically please, sorry about these people.
Yeah, Megan, and let's talk about something else in the meantime.
How's the weather in your part of England?
Pretty shit.
Yeah, it's not great, is it?
And by that I mean raining, so it's nice.
Oh, pre you guys
It's
prepare
a bit of
for a
rain.
cyclone on Thursday. It's passing Portugal about tomorrow, Thursday. So yeah, I
I wonder
found
if
it,
by
and I will.
the way I might see it.
I
We're
will.
due some pretty heavy thunderstorms. So
present to everyone.
Hopefully some snow.
Yay. And here we are. This is the actual bulletin member bulletin statement, and this year marks the 70th anniversary after 1947. The Manhattan Project scientists gathered and started to do this. A bit down here. Here we go. This here is where we will start. In 1947, there was one technology that potential to destroy the planet. That was nuclear power. They say that today, rising temperatures on an industrial scale of burning fossil fuels, and which is here, that's global warming, cyber realm, artificial intelligence, biology, biological weaponry, etc., are also in the main boards. But I don't think they know that global warming. We'll start off with global warming, then I'll ask my two guests to have to what they think. But global warming isn't really a short-term danger; it's more of a long-term danger. I agree, and I no, I don't agree. I am positively certain that the climate change that now is caused by us humans, because we have not just polluted the we have cutting down the forests that once used to absorb all the carbon dioxide and but keep it balanced and so on at an extremely rate that is just unbalancing the atmosphere and so on. So that's a short term, but the long term than the short. The long term, the short term ones are still nuclear power. What do you guys think?
You can go first if you want, Megan. Or do you want me to go first? Bitch, it's just before.
Come on, one of these. God.
Now that I've said that, Megan needs to go first.
I know you've told me that you guys have read this, and
I definitely have. Yeah.
So I've picked out a few things which are sort of pertinent. This, the first statement, the rising temperatures, global warming. We know it's occurring, but it's not an immediate threat. We are just seeing more extreme storms. We're not seeing world-ending.
I think that there's a lot of, how do you say it, a lot of alarmism when it comes to global warming and climate change. I do think it's a huge issue, and I do think that government should take steps to reduce the amount of emissions from companies and also from itself. But I don't think it's nearly as bad as what they're saying in the short term, at least. In the long term, that's a vastly different matter.
I know it occurs. I'm going to be a bit of a shit poster here, shit talker, going the other way, even though it's not what I really believe, because I'm as an archaeologist, I want natural shit. I wish I could live. I wish I could live back then. That's I was born 25,000 years too late. So yeah. That's me. I would have met Neanderthals still in the Iberian Peninsula. They died out 24,000. So, yeah, I would have met them. Interesting. But I want global warming to accelerate, in fact. I want the Greenland ice sheets to melt, to stop the Gulf Current, to bring about another glacial maximum.
But before we do that, we need to ship all of the SJWs off to Greenland.
Sweden, because that'll Sweden, at the height of the last glacial period, 22,000 years ago, it was under 2 kilometers of ice. Now let that sink in.
Not only that, but you know, that Sweden is the sort of society that a lot of them are advocating for nowadays, so it's perfect.
Man, I'm going to start a campaign to let the actual Swedes, blind blue eyes Swedes, come to Portugal. Not the SJWs. Fuck them. No, they can stay back there with the Muslims, and then Portugal will be fine. Not the Spain. They also are a bit crazy people there in Spain. So let's go.
Build a wall.
Build a wall. Yeah, exactly.
Well, one thing I do want to point out before moving on, actually, and this is something which I've noticed, which I haven't seen brought up. A lot of climate change people rightfully point out that if we don't deal with it, you know, with the issue of climate change now, then our kids will suffer down the line. But what I don't see a lot is they don't talk about the financial burden that they're putting on their kids when it comes to the national debt, because who is going to pay that down?
Yeah.
So it's just a sort of, you know, you care about the kids here, but you don't care about them here when you're putting this huge burden on them.
Yeah, exactly.
I am interested in, you mentioned earlier governments putting more pressure on governments to reduce emissions. But it depends on the government, because some government, depending on the type of government, for example, conservative governments like to sell off public assets to private companies. And that makes it harder to regulate them, but try and get them to work with the government to reduce it, because they're not interested in it, are they?
That's true, and that's another reason why I think that we would benefit a lot from having a much, much smaller government. Because
I'm so glad what I said made some sense then.
I know what you mean. But yeah. If you have a smaller government, then it's a lot easier to actually tell for the average citizen what the government is doing. So I want, personally at least, a smaller government which has a strong environmental agency.
Environment can be so lucrative.
It can be, and I'm sure that it can be abused, but smaller, you know.
No, if you can, most people take advantage of anything they can.
Yeah. In short, I think we need a system which the average person can follow, not a system now where you look at the US system, for example, and let's be honest, you can't just do, you know, even an hour of research and find out what is happening within the system, what money is going where, etc. You need to really sit down and do a lot of research, and I don't think that's right for a system.
Okay, I think that's, yeah, I agree with that. And like I said, it can be super lucrative if without unrealistic burdens and regulations, you can regulate to have a minimum. After that, it's just basically exerting power, which I think the European Union is doing at the moment in many things. I like the way they are basically reducing oil consumption as much as possible, and that's introducing Euro 4 compliancy and all that. It sort of is sticking it into the oil producing countries, I think. So that's my view on that. Okay, let's go on to what caught my eye when I read the statement is this part here. It says, I've highlighted this part. It says, this year's clock deliberations felt more urgent than usual. On the big topics concerning the board, world leaders made too little progress in the face of continuing turbulence. Okay, this statement caught my eye. Why would they need to be that urgent in deliberating? They've never done it before. And towards a bit later, I'll give two examples which are very poignant. They go on to justify their concerns, basically stating that fake news is dangerous, and here we go. The new global realities emerge as trusted information came under attack. Fake news was on the rise, and words were used in cavalier and often reckless ways. This statement here, I think, is a bit hypocritical, which I will also mention later. So just keep in mind, it'll become later. I've set up the things today. They gave the example of the fake news almost starting a war, where Pakistan flexed its nuclear muscle in response to a fabricated news story about Israel. So, did you guys hear about that?
No.
Well, when was it? I think it was about November-ish, a little bit before the actual U.S. elections. There was a news story where Pakistan went on to a heightened alert because of that, of an actual news story that said that Israel was planning on a first strike.
Where was the news story from?
Of Israel. The news story was, oh God, I can't remember now. I can't remember outlet put it out.
I think two lines above, we've got it. It says fake news. It must come off YouTube.
Oh, it did, yeah. Fake YouTube, social media. It was on social media. It was social media news.
Yeah, that explains it.
And
about that particular foreign minister being so easy to manipulate, to make a statement, a tweet because of something they saw that was fake anyway.
But Megan, everything on the internet is correct.
Oh, you're so right.
Exactly. If you look at the news, stories, articles, you open, you click on any of them, you see a bit of the story, then you see tweets, half or three quarters of the page of tweets, and then you get a little conclusion at the end.
I know my tweets are correct because whenever I tweet directly to someone and say, this is your daily reminder that you are a faggot, I know it is true.
Is that, yeah. Yeah, I try to back up as much as possible my tweets with factual.
Oh, I include citations, you know.
Exactly. Yeah. So this is their premises. They had to deliberate early because fake news has been taking over the airwaves, and they could have a nuclear incident. If we go on to the next bit, which is more interesting, this was the editor in chief, the director and publisher, Rachel Bronson from Chicago. Nothing interesting about being there, but just she put it there. They go on to say that last year, you can see over the course of 2016, global security landscape darkened because the community failed to come to grips with humanity's most pressing existential threats, nuclear weapons and climate change. I agree with nuclear weapons. I don't agree with climate change. Climate change is not pressing. It is a threat, a looming threat, but it's an ongoing threat that's slowly gathering pace.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
Yeah.
I think it's better than most now when it comes to it, but I wouldn't call it a pressing existential threat.
Yeah, exactly. No. We are going to have here in Europe, the UK, Iberia, France, there's a cyclone, a really bad storm that's heading our way. And so that is obviously, because it's fucking warm. It's supposed to have snowed, and we're having temperatures of six. I'm having, outside it's 6.3 degrees now where I live, and I live a kilometer above sea level in northern Portugal. It should be snowing. It should be a meter of snow at least. It's not. I hate that. So climate change is still going on, but. Back to the article. It says that the United States and Russia, they hold 90% of the world's nuclear weapons. They remain at odds because of Syria and Ukraine borders of NATO. No, they were at odds before this January 20th, the 20th of January. Now they are not at odds. Don't you guys agree? Mm-hmm. Putin's already found. Well,
I'd agree with you that Putin wants to open up negotiations dialogue with Trump.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
He's talked. They've talked.
In that regard, we're definitely a lot better off than if Hillary was in charge.
Yeah. I don't like either. I hate them both. So anyone that's listening thinks, oh, he's supporting Trump. No, fuck him. The identity politics voted him in, so all your fucking fault.
Well, that and also probably the lack of infrastructure in certain parts of the United States.
Absolutely, yes. If you're like here where I live, if you don't have a job and you're struggling to feed your family, you don't care if you're being called racist. You want a job. The threats that they mention here is always high, but not as high as the commission say, because they go on down to say that. They are both continuing to modernize their nuclear forces. They've been doing that. They later say on they've been doing that since 2011 at least, modernizing their nuclear forces under Obama. They started modernizing, and he had, which I will later show the difference. Between the clocks in historical terms, North Korea. I don't take North Korea as seriously as they do. My rationale is this: North Korea is controlled by China. It is. It's if it wasn't, 8 or 9 million people there in their whole population would flee into China. Because they are fucking starving. They don't want 9 million refugees at this moment flooding into their Eastern borders, northeastern borders.
I'm not entirely sure if I'd agree with that, to be honest. There's a lot of resentment from Chinese people to the North Koreans. And not just that, I think it's better to describe the relationship as a sort of North Korea is kind of like a little brother who is just tolerated, but throws his toys all over the room.
Oh, yeah, but he's still controlled. He won't let the little brother grab a knife and kill the sister, for example.
Oh, of course not. But
that's South Korea.
That being said, it's still stepping out of its bounds. So I don't think it should be taken somewhat seriously.
Of course. Kim Il-jong is... I don't know, how would you characterize Kim Il-jong? If I don't know if you guys read enough about him. I think he's an SJW, to be honest. His feelings, if they're hurt, he kills his
family. Is he the current leader of North Korea?
Yeah, Kim Il-jong, yeah.
The psychopath that when his feelings are hurt so much or anyone doesn't give him absolute attention,
salute, he has them SJW
the most extreme way possible.
Exactly, SJWs, don't you reckon?
That does sound quite regressive, but that's a whole level away from, you know, SJWs.
Yeah, thankfully they don't have that power.
Thankfully.
Yeah, but he has the power. That's the... That's why we shouldn't power let SJWs get into power.
Oh, this person raises a good point about North Korea, though. North Korea uses less power and produces less light pollution than any other nation. So actually, they're helping when it comes to climate change.
Have you seen their advice? You've seen the globe thing. They do a lights off thing, don't they, in their country?
Also, Walt, from what I've read, they don't do that. They actually deport you back if you're found.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about the Chinese to North Koreans.
Because they don't want, like I said, they don't want the flood of 8 million starving North Koreans into their country. They can't go to the south because they have a kilometer wide minefield. So where would they go?
So what a lot of them do is they basically go through China. They go over the river. They go through China to another country.
Mm-hmm.
Through the desert north, or I can't remember what the exact name is, but I think it's Taos or something like that, and then they get a plane from there to South Korea or somewhere else.
Because they can't just go straight across, because the soldiers at the border between north and south, aren't there?
Yeah, exactly. So you'd need to get
a plane. Isn't it British-American troops?
Sorry?
I remember seeing something a long time ago. That originally there were British and American soldiers stationed between the North-South divide.
I'm not sure.
At the moment there are some American. They're still there. The America and South Korea at the table at Panmunjom. So the base is there. So yes, it's sort of. I don't know about Britain though.
Maybe they stopped doing that. I don't know.
Yeah, probably, yeah.
Space Jam 2, peace with North Korea is easily achievable. Just offer Kim Jong-il a role in Space Jam 2.
Offer him a role in another Team America film. I want him to sing Rongru.
I think Rule Raven wants a link to the stream.
This part here, which I'm highlighting now back to the thing. By wavering public confidence in the democratic institutions required to deal with major world threats. I agree with Europe. That statement, I totally agree with what is happening in Europe. At least here in Portugal, we still don't trust much of our governance, even though they are very, very centrist.
I think that's a good thing, though.
Oh, yeah, it is.
I think it's great that we don't trust the government.
No, exactly, yeah. That's what I mean. I see where they're coming from. But it doesn't mean that the leaders were not elected in a democratic process. They bring up here that the deception campaigns directed by Russian government, they're disrupting the US elections. There hasn't, they've been a lot of speculation, but there hasn't been produced one iota of proof. I will be the first one to say, yes, there's the proof. I've changed my mind. But until they do that, this is speculation about Russia hacking the US elections. No, there's no proof of that.
And wouldn't that be fake news, where you just claim something and then, you know, you just believe it?
Yeah, exactly. That's fake news. They're falling into their own, they're falling into that trap, which they just before denounced. And that's I think that's how I read it. I am not, of course, I can be, that's my only my opinion. But where was the outrage when Obama said that the UK, if they vote for Brexit, would be put in the back of the crowd, in the back of the line? That's
we're all too busy laughing, saying that's bullshit, and you know it.
Yeah, but he said it, and no one. There was no outrage.
You didn't hear about it from major media sources. They instead ran with it as if, you know, that was a reason to vote Remain. Whereas, I remember tweeting about this, thinking this is utter horseshit. Sorry, dude, but you're leaving soon. No one's listening to you.
Exactly. But do you see the hypocrisy that of what he said is actually trying to interfere? Sorry, with fake news that Russia did it. Russia hacked a Wisconsin election. They used paper ballots.
Well, that's clearly rigged. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, clearly. That's it. Yeah.
The Russians.
Yeah, the Russians, yeah.
They make fantastic glowing tea, though.
Oh, yes. And it's not Earl Grey, though.
No.
Okay, jumping back here. They talk about how words matter, and Trump has made plenty to say over the last year. This statement here really made me think, because I've been following, of course, everyone follows the American elections, and anyone remember when, probably not everyone, does anyone remember when Clinton said on the third debate, I think it was, that they asked her, what would you do if the United States was attacked, cyber attack, military attack, trade attack, and all that? She said, yes, she would use all means in her disposal to fight back, or basically to counter it. All means, I would gather, I took as even nuclear war. That's how I took it. Assertions on Russia, that Russia was hacking, because it was the time when they released the Clinton mails, the Podesta mails, and so on. So Democratic.
We're not supposed to see those.
No, so, of course not. You know. We're not CNN exactly. Yeah. It was about that time, and she basically said that asserted that was Russia. So I'm still waiting for the proof. I will be the first to acknowledge it if the proof is shown. I've seen reports of assertions by the FBI, by the CIA, by counterintelligence, by that British counterintelligence operative, former British counterintelligence operative, who wrote the report that Russia had filmed Trump in a golden shower party. I'm still waiting for the videos. Fuck, I want to see them. If the women were that hot, Russian women are supposedly nice looking. I'm still waiting for that. And just for the lols, by the way. So, yeah, all these... This says here that words have consequences. Now, I'm going to take you back some to history. I'm the oldest one here. I'm an old cunt. I have a video, but I can't play it back. It basically was uttered on August 11, 1984. Ronald Reagan was trying out his mic or doing a mic test. And I was at school that time in Australia. I was a young kid. And he uttered these words. Let's see if I got them here. He said, basically, he basically uttered this phrase. I'm sort of paraphrasing because it's off my head. I don't want to play the video because it said, as of now, I have issued an executive order outlawing the Soviet Union. We start bombing in 10 minutes.
Wait, what?
Yes, he actually said that.
I think I remember hearing about this, yeah.
Yeah, I will post God, I can't post the link in the side chat. No. I think I can post it on my own fucking chat, public chat. It's the video that I found, Control C. Let's see if I can do my own. What the hell? I can't even post my own.
Fucking lame as shit.
Yeah.
Carlos. Yes. Do you mind if Rule Raven joins?
No, send him a link. Shit. You'll be faster than I do.
Americans, I'm pleased to tell you today that I signed legislation that will outlaw Russia forever. We will begin bombing in 5 minutes. Yeah, it is a quote he said.
Exactly, yeah. It was on radio. I was at school.
1984. He's a live broadcast from his ranch. Yeah.
I was fucking terrified.
Oh, NPR. He joked around with NPR engineers during the mic check. I think that's why he did it. I think he was messing around with them. Yeah. And Russia was not amused.
No, they actually went into they up at the DEFCOM in Russia. He called them. He did. Yeah, it was fucking troll. But what? 84. I was 17 years old. I was doing year 11. I was fucking terrified as shit when I heard that.
I wasn't even born then.
Sorry about that. Yeah, I told you, I'm an old cunt.
You really are.
I'm an old cunt, yeah. I'm young at heart. I'm young at heart, so yeah.
I keep telling myself that every morning these days.
And I'll see if I can send him the link. Sorry about this, guys.
That's okay.
I'll have to stop sharing. That.
That's beautiful.
What?
That quote, I like it. I really do.
Yeah, and he said that. And if you guys look at the actual Doomsday clock changes in 1984, well, let me invite someone, and we'll get back to. This one. I have to invite a friend. I just saw his tweet now on Twitter. Sorry about that, Raven. Control C.
I've already given him the link on Twitter. So.
Oh, you have? Oh, cool. Then he should join in. So get back to the. It's a bit too big, I think. See if I can increase it. Oh, that's better.
Speaking real, then we can't hear you.
What? Sorry? You guys can hear me?
No, I can't hear Real Raven.
Oh.
Yeah, I can hear you now. Okay.
Oh, okay. Cool. Hello? Oh, Raven. Oh, good. Man. Sorry, man. I just opened the window. I had it. Because I have a lot of.
Benny sent me the thing on Twitter. How are you? How are you?
Oh, man. Yeah. Let's go a bit forward to the 1984. What happened then when they set their clocks in 1984? Jump back then. Here we go. 1984. It's this one. I'll just open, increase it a bit. There we go. It's this one.
Sharing.
I'm going to share. I just have to highlight.
He says it's this one, but nothing's to say.
No, I'm actually talking to myself. Sorry about that, guys. There we go. Now it should be shared now, right? It should be. Yeah. This one, 1984. They had it at 3 minutes to midnight. And where is it? Here we go. The U.S. and Soviet relations reached the iciest point in decades. The dialogues between the two superpowers virtually stopped. Every channel of communication had been constricted or shut down. Every form of contact had been attenuated or cut off. The arms control negotiations had been reduced to a species of propaganda, and they only let it at 2-3 minutes. The United States flouted a few arms control agreements, and they even announced the quote unquote Star Wars program.
Mm-hmm.
And it's set at 3 minutes. Ooh. Hello, is it?
Yeah, Doc.
Yeah, mate.
Glad you could make it. We're just talking about Ronald Reagan's famous speech where he was testing a microphone. He may have not have been what was the one you got? A Yeti microphone, but it was still a microphone. And
am I coming through clear?
A bit louder.
Am I coming through all right?
Bit low sound.
Okay. Oh, that's because I have a game adjustment.
Up the volume.
Loud enough. Do I have
you're loud enough?
Volume? Okay, Raven. Okay.
You have to. Yes. Yes. Well.
He would put nuts inside us. Nuts inside
while
us.
While you guys do that, let's see what's the link.
Oh, you know.
Okay. Oh, he dropped again. Oh, he'd come back. Moist.
Oops.
How much did Megan pay you to say that?
It's the same.
Nick, it's still a bit low volume. Wizard.
Oh, wait a second. That's why.
But you got a cool new icon anyway.
Yeah, no, that's.
Oh, no, that's better.
I had the wrong mic.
Oh,
much better.
Awesome now. That is perfect.
Yeah.
Wizard. Not Wizard. I'm sorry. Oh, God, I'm confused. Raven, do you want to share this, mate? What is it?
Put it in the chat and I'll share it.
Exactly.
I'll share anything.
Use the site chat. There you go. That's the actual Reagan video where he said it.
If you okay, want to, let's get it.
No, so what are we talking
about? We're talking about
I thought you wanted to share Sargon's last tweet.
When was it? No.
The one he was banned for.
No. Well, that's another. We'll come back to that later if we have time. We're almost done on this anyway.
I'm just joking. Let me see. Can I set it? Can you hear the sound? Wait. Did you hear that?
No.
You didn't, did you? Okay. Wait a sec. Just set up voice meter.
Okay. I'll get back to the other one. Just have to share my screen. Tell me when you want to stop, and I'll stop sharing my screen, and we'll get back to the actual article, which is wrong one. Oh, come on, Jesus! Here we go. That one. I have so many stuff here.
You know,
sorry about that.
A 10-year delay in the Soviet Union of delivery of an automobile.
Do you hear that?
And only one out of seven families.
Okay, cool. I'll give you the.
The one that I sent. Yeah, that one. Where is it?
In collecting stories that are told in the Soviet Union by their people among themselves, which reveal they've got a great sense of humor, but they've also got a pretty cynical attitude toward their system. And I told this one, Bill, you'll have to hear it again. I told it in the car.
That's not the one I sent you. Mine's only 9 seconds long. It's,
Fellow Americans, I'm pleased to tell you today that I've signed legislation that will outlaw Russia forever and begin bombing in 5 minutes.
Was that a joke?
Yes, it was a joke.
He was testing the microphone.
Yeah, he was actually testing the microphone, except that the technician left, actually hit transmit on it. It's brilliant. I was saying, those that just joined, I crapped my pants then when I heard that. I was in year 11. I was 17 years old. I was terrified of Russia then. I actually feared Russia, that nuclear war, because Australia had the radar station in Northern Territory.
Mm-hmm.
Pine Gap, that's the one. Pine Gap. It wasn't in Northern Territory, it was New South Wales. Ah, God, my tongue is going. Yeah. So, yeah. Wasn't covered then, and they were covered this, that words matter. So words matter only if it's Trump in this thing.
You're saying that?
Go on. What were you going to say?
No, I was going to ask what cunt said that.
What? This is the words matter is the bulletin of the atomic scientists, the Doomsday Clock Statement 217. Page 3, yeah.
Yeah, no, that's a bunch of... Sorry, I forgot for a moment what we were going to be streaming about. And just got home. Yeah, that's a bunch of crap. I mean, granted...
Yeah.
I mean, Donald Trump is not necessarily good for world stability or security, to be certain, but say that we're going to move that much closer to Doomsday. I suppose you could say maybe it holds some water in that he wants to build a bigger nuclear arsenal and Russia's like, yes, us too. So that's not a great, that's not the best notion on earth. You know, like, hey, let's have more nukes in the world. Why the fuck not? Even though we've got plenty to destroy the world several times over. But to say we're closer to Doomsday now, when there are no countries outside of, as far as I'm aware, outside of Pakistan and India, who are actively pointing nuclear weapons at each other.
We'll go back onto the actual timeline a little bit later on.
It's just that, just to note, I'm old enough that I still remember being terrified of Ronald Reagan too. I think everybody else on this... You and me, Carlos. I think everybody else on the stream is too young.
Of course they were. They were either sprogs, eggs, or
gametes.
Or so on.
gametes.
Well, I mean, I'm 33.
Kind of. You're a fucking kid, man. Jesus. I'm an old cunt,
baby.
I'm a geriatric. Continuing a little bit down here, little square basically sums up what the whole statement is about. The board's decision to move the clock less than a full minute reflects a simple reality. As this statement is issued, Donald Trump has been in the US president for only a matter of days, yet they still moved it half a minute. So there is an agenda, because the summary. In short, even though he has now taken office, the president, in temperate statements, lack of openness, he promised, he's doing what he promised. He's not open. He could be he's the biggest fucking moron that has ever held office in the United States, but he's doing what he promised. That's fully openness. And questionable cabinet. Go on.
No, I was going to say, I can't really remember another president who actually walked into office and then went bananas fulfilling their campaign promises.
Yeah, exactly.
He wants to take the rest of the 4 years off, you see. He just wants everything out of the way in the first month.
I think so. I really think so.
On Twitter.
Exactly.
I think this basically, this page, after that, it just goes on to other, this statement goes on to other things, just elaborating a bit more on the nuclear power. They talk about the Iran nuclear agreement basically settles stuff, but I don't think so. I'll put the link on the my page of this article, or you guys just the listeners just Google a Doomsday Clock statement. It'll appear there.
I have a question though. You know, obviously,
yes.
The Doomsday Clock, even though it's 2.5 minutes to midnight, it has never been observed to move in a linear fashion. It goes backwards and forwards. So exactly. the position on the clock, whether it's 2.5 minutes to midnight or 2 hours or 10 seconds, it's not really relevant. It doesn't go forward, and it doesn't go forward. When it goes forward, it doesn't go forward in a linear fashion. It's pointless.
With that though, is that it's a metaphor. And I think it's a quite smart metaphor in a way, because it was designed so they would basically alarm you, so that you would think, oh, we're really, really close to this.
So well, see, I had
pretty smart.
Well, I had a clock like that once myself, and I was like constantly late to work. So I don't know why they keep that clock around. They should just get a digital one.
Would it, Benny, would it lose all its credibility if it hit 1 second after midnight? And we were still around.
It hasn't. I've sent the link to the people in the stream, except you, Raven. Sorry about that, man. But the PDF. Yeah, you have the PDF exactly. You don't have it.
No, I do have it. I have it. It's okay.
Oh well, yeah. It's never gone this slow before. I've looked at it. Their timeline. We are now at the lowest ever, and there are two situations that happened, historical situations, which should have gone to 10 seconds before midnight, and they haven't. Mm-hmm. One was 1963. That year was very, very auspicious. It was John F. Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson, presidents. There was a Democratic presidency in that time, that year. JFK was assassinated, but just before that, or around that period, we had the Cuban Missile Crisis. We actually were on the brink of an actual nuclear war. America blockaded Cuba. Russia was sending in submarines. They were I think I've seen a report. They were half an hour from pushing the button.
Mm-hmm.
The Russians were actually half an hour, or they received a message, high level message from the Kremlin to the submarine commander, who had an American destroyer in his sights. It was almost in the last minute that they sent that to stand down. So, and the clock was set at 12 minutes to midnight. In 1963. 1962, when that happened, is not there.
It sounds a bit like a reverse scenario of the Red October, the movie with Sean Connery, right?
Yeah, exactly.
The Russian submarine deflecting, and they were almost blowing it up.
I like that movie. I love that movie.
Then again, actually, think about it. When it came to this missile crisis, was that a really, really fast thing that happened, which then went into, you know, just dissipated? Because maybe they didn't have enough time to actually update it.
The Russians stood down, right? That's the first thing they did. The blockade was lifted after the last. Basically, they let the ships in. They loaded the missiles back. They were cruise missiles, not cruise missiles. They were short range ballistic missiles. Cuba to United States was not that far, so they wouldn't have to be big. They were actually mobile, most of them were mobile. Launches, so they were packed back onto the ships and taken back, and it was diffused in 1963. But my point was that they did not bring the clock between 1960 and 1963, which was only the two measurements that did, was 7 in 1960 minutes to midnight and 12 minutes in 1963. And we were minutes from a fucking nuclear war.
You know what reminds me of now? You remember Zeno's paradox of the race between Achilles and the turtle?
You know that one? Yes.
Just for the listeners, so basically it's a 100-yard race, and the turtle is given a 90-yard lead, so she gets to 90 yards ahead. So Zeno argued that Achilles could never catch up with the turtle, because when the turtle has the 90-yard lead, the race begins, and by the time Achilles runs to the 90-yard line, the turtle is now 9 yards ahead. And by the time Achilles runs another 9 yards, the turtle is now 0.9 yards ahead. And by the time Achilles runs another 0.9 yards, the turtle is now only 0.09 yards ahead, and so on. So Achilles never catches the turtle. That's what the doomsday clock reminds me of. You know, you cannot ever set it to doomsday, because then you would lose the credibility. So if there was a rule that said you cannot set it back, it can only go forward. If we're now at 10 seconds, then maybe in 2020 we are at 0.8 seconds.
We can set it back, because in 1968 they at 7 minutes, and in 1969 they went back to 10 minutes.
See, the problem is none of you are using leap years. None of you have daylight savings time.
Exactly. Possibly.
That would be medically. Daylight savings time. Oh! We made
a small
prediction, right? What is it? It's not a prediction. It's just the closeness of the doomsday, but it's not a prediction of time, right?
No. It's just an analysis of what the scientists that belong to this organization perceive as... How close to that scenario of the total annihilation are we?
But they're also saying that Trump is literally Hitler, right?
Basically, because in their mission statement, like I said before you guys come, it was just me and Bene and Armagon, which are suspiciously quiet now. And I wish they'd speak more, because I wouldn't have to. I'm having a beer and I would love to enjoy myself while you guys speak. They basically say that they are the scientific advancements that involve both benefits and risks to humanity, with the goal of influencing public policy to protect our planet and its inhabitants. I also agree with that. So I agree with that. I said that I do and I still do. Mm-hmm. That is their mission statement. It's on their page, so it's easy to find. But yeah, that scenario in 1963, we were so close to annihilation, is only mirrored again in 1984, when I just repeated, when Reagan uttered that lovely sentence, that phrase, that froze my veins while I was at school. And that was sent that said. No, it was his statement, yeah.
Yeah, but that wasn't the seriousness, so that wasn't the sentence that set the doomsday clock to that, was it? Wasn't it like...
It was a whole Star Wars, that statement. Brezhnev and Reagan were at each other. 84, what happened also in 84? Afghanistan, for the Russian Afghanistan was still going.
Oh, yes.
Yes, so that was instability in that area. There was a mini crisis, economic crisis, if I can remember, in 1984.
Over here with the savings and loan crisis with Keating.
Yeah, we in Australia, we also, my dad was unemployed for a couple of months, and... We noticed it, yeah. So basically, these idiots, no, they're not idiots, come on, I'm being too harsh on them. But I want to contrast them, 2:15 and 2:16. In 2:12, 5 minutes to midnight. 2:10, 6 minutes to midnight. Obama, 2:07, Bush Jr., he was at 5 minutes to midnight. Nothing happened. Climate change, basically. North Korea did their first nuclear test. 2:10, 6 minutes. 2:12, 5 minutes. 2:15, 3 minutes. So basically, in the last 2 years, it's been at 3 minutes under Obama. And everyone freaked. Yeah. Everyone freaked out when they released this statement. Everyone was freaking out. Even here in Portugal, our media went fucking crazy. They said, "Oh, we are fucking end of the world and all that shit. It's Trump's fault." And then I went and looked at this. No, actually, just continuation of the shit storm that the world is in at the moment. Yeah.
Did you know that in February 1984 the TED conferences was founded? TED.
So oh yeah!
All
yeah,
the evil that started.
That's probably.
Now I'm going to switch my slideshow, and you're going to listen to me as I walk across the stage. Going to wait a little bit, use a few words you may have heard at some point, then walk back across the stage.
Well, speaking of TED, have you seen that TED talk? It was a TEDx talk. And it was this guy who was, I think, funnily enough, he was talking about climate change. But he, I think his name's Sam Hyde. And he was just screaming and everything.
Well, didn't Sam do a TED talk in, like, Philly at Drexel, where he was standing there in, like, a plastic, plastic knight's armor? Talking about all this fucked up, like, this fucked up nonsense about, like, in the future. That was Sam, right?
Sam Hyde, I think so.
I think that one we've got to look it up. Why ask each other questions? Yeah, Sam Hyde TED Talk. Yeah, why ask each other questions while we're on the internet? Yeah, that was him. The Sam Hyde's 2070 paradigm shift.
Oh shit! I saw that.
I didn't even. It was funny because like this entire time, this is the first time it's ever actually sunk in. I'm like, holy shit! I remember seeing that. Yeah, I remember seeing that years ago. And now, that was the white supremacist, just a mass murderer himself.
Yeah,
he looks ridiculous.
Oh my god, he looks weird. Paradigm shift.
I think you're just jealous. Maybe you should Photoshop your head onto him with the plastic armor.
Yeah, but if you do that, like Gregor will probably come after you.
He would.
1984, the first Macintosh was sold as well in 1984. Apple Computer places the Macintosh PC on sale.
I remember that, like the commercials, the 1984 reference of the woman running back then, even running with a sledgehammer into the screen, whilst Goldstein was bearded. In the big screen, she throws the hammer, it breaks, and then you see the Apple II computer. Macintosh, the first Macintosh, 1984.
Yeah. Yeah, the two floppy drives.
Exactly, yeah.
Brilliant.
God, I'm fucking old. Jesus.
We are.
I remember all that shit.
So... You were talking about the environment earlier when I decided I'll wave and let you put me on. I thought that a lot of the environment causes, and especially those hybrid cars, and also things like organic food, are very much kind of staple for the, well, not necessarily rich, but, you know, for the well-off. Only they can afford to be environmentally friendly anyway. You know, the hoi polloi, they can't afford it. You know, they have to burn their coal and whatnot.
Well, that's actually true. That's also because it's a relatively...
It's luxury. So I think environmentalism is a... Sorry?
It's a relatively new thing.
Yeah, I think that it is a... environmentalism is a luxury item. At the moment, it is. And you could go to a bio market and buy some food there. Everything's like triple the price, you know.
Well, that kind. I mean, that sort of like... It's like any other activism. I mean, most activism these days, take the Women's March, for instance. Could anyone actually definitively tell me what that was about? Of course not.
No.
But everyone who went felt really good about themselves, and that's the point. But, I mean, this modern, you know, the green movement that we've got now, that's really what that's about, too. A bunch of pretentious twats who want to feel like they're doing their part, not so much that they can actually have any impact, but simply so they can feel like they are. Meanwhile, like the real environmental impacts of the shit that real environmentalists are trying to really stab at are being felt in the poorest places where the droughts are happening, where like the dumps of tech waste are going to. And even funnier too, those who are like micro blogging about living green on their fucking iPads that are built with materials mined in places that are too poor to afford not to by effectively day wage slaves who have to live around toxic waste because that's where we put it when we're done with it.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. I try my best to be as environmentally friendly as I can. I live in a national park and the only one that we have here. So I try my best, but I still, I have for heating, I have a stone, a wood fired stove.
Same here.
Which is connected to
living in the middle ages, Carlos, aren't you?
Of course,
Did you see Sam Harris? He was saying that it's really bad to be burning wood. It's kind of environmentally most unfriendly. It's really strange.
But and,
he took a perspective of some guy who lives in the city, you know, or in the suburbs, and just burns wood for his as a luxury item, you know. You don't really need to burn wood because you have central heating. Well, actually, my wood burner fires my central heating. I don't burn.
Same here.
I don't burn oil here, you know.
I actually have three systems of heating. They're all connected.
Yeah.
Radiators. There are those radiators which in all the thing. I have the wood stove. The wood stove which heats up. I have an electrical cylinder, and I also have a diesel burner, and they I have to, man. It just the electricity is fucking expensive here, diesel is expensive here, but the wood that I burn, it grows because I'm surrounded by my properties, or they grow naturally. Broom, which is the most the common wood that we have here, after 3 or 4 years, you let the shrub broom grow, you cut it, it burns beautifully. So what I burn, it grows back.
Cool. And you say properties, so you have more than one.
They're fields, and they used to be fields here.
Portugal's fucking poor, so he's just buying shit up left and right.
I'm still waiting to inherit them. They are under my dad's name, and I hope I don't have to inherit them for a long time yet.
Just go and pick some mushrooms and make some soup for your dad.
I went robotic. That's the connection pillow. Nihilus pillow is telling me I was going robot there.
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
I'm playing with my new toy. It's like this is a nifty little microphone. So,
where do you put it?
oh, guys! I almost forgot. I have to give a shout out to a special someone. Not a special someone. A friend of mine. He had me on his stream once, and I follow him. He follows me, and I'm going to make a small. He asked me basically this. It's Vito D'Amico. He asked me to convey that he has a big dick. So my dear friend Vito. I still remember the kind invitation you had me on for your stream, your podcast. So, yes, he apparently has a big dick. So there you go.
We'll keep it in mind.
Yeah. Is that what you were inspecting last night?
No, how can I inspect anyone? I only inspect myself. I don't inspect anyone. So let's get back to the conversation.
Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to get Ashley Judd to say that she's nasty, but I can't find it.
Oh, she's not nasty, she's just crazy. Jesus Christ. Anyway, just so you guys know, I was inspired. I'm not the first one to talk about this. Sinatra Talks, the YouTuber. He does quite good. A little shout out to him as well. He won't. He talked about this first. The Doomsday Clock. So I give him credit for not to inspire me. I wanted to talk about it, but he was first. So yeah.
Hmm. Oh, what the fuck?
Let's sigh. I have rum at least. So yeah, the world's going. We're all fucked. We're going to be covered in nukes and Nazis.
Nazis, and, yeah.
Yeah, we're going to be. Yeah, the resistance is going to be like, you know, it's going to step its game up. It's going to be go out and punch a go out and punch a nuclear bomb. Go punch it, punch it. Show it who's boss. And then when you're done with that, go, you know, go rough up a Nazi. And you can tell if they're a Nazi because they have different opinions than you. So basically, anyone you meet,
everyone. Yep.
Yeah, I mean, like, and while we're at it, punch anybody who plays Macklemore in public, just because. Yeah.
Because they're lucky enough to find their clothes in a thrift store.
Yeah, and they might as well. They're probably Nazis too. Let's be honest. They're probably Nazis. People who drive blue cars
are Nazis. Yes,
those are Nazis. We all know them because I have a red car.
Bicyclist.
Clearly, anybody with a blue car.
I have a green 4x4. So yeah.
Yeah. Anybody who doesn't drive a Subaru, actually, anybody who doesn't drive a Subaru Outback wagon, that's pretty much a Nazi.
Yes.
You got to knock them out. Just run up to them and punch them. It's perfectly fine.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody who eats what?
Ramen.
No. Those are poor people. Those are college students, man. You can't go punch in the college students.
No. They're not Nazis.
They just. Yeah. Well, okay. So they're protected. But they're anybody protected, who yeah. anybody who takes an Uber though at this point. Anybody who takes an Uber. Oh boy!
They're the Gestapo. They're not even Nazis. They're the Gestapo.
That's straight up SS territory. That's yeah. Those fuckers. Yeah. Anybody who uses any words with any syllables that are or sound like re. You know, if you say like rewind the tape or something, punch that dude immediately.
Or reverse.
What's that?
Actually, you know what? But because we need to keep it consistent. We need to keep it 100. So someone is going to have to go and punch Brianna Wu because the name she selected for herself when she stopped being Brian signified it was a dog whistle. It was a secret Nazi dog whistle. So. There we go. Wow, you know, we're going to have a really busy decade here. If we want to avoid world catastrophe, if we want to avoid getting to like 2 minutes past midnight and have to look at the smoldering ashes of our family plots and our children's hopes and dreams all smoldering upon some hillside. I don't know where the hillside is, but we'll find one and we'll put them there and they'll smolder there. Unless we want that to happen, we need to start punching.
Wouldn't it be great if we were on the other side of that 12 o'clock mark and then we could stop worrying about it? You know, it's done.
Yeah, it would be. But here's the problem, though. I mean, like, when Doomsday happens, who's going to be left to actually push the clock there? Because don't they do it by hand?
Yeah, they do. They actually draw it.
Well, then we don't have to worry because the clock will never actually make it to midnight. When the apocalypse comes, no one will be left to actually make the clock move, so the apocalypse therefore can never come. Ouroboros, snake eating its tail, I win again.
Does anybody remember Ron Milloway's, the restaurant at the end of
the universe? At the end of the universe.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I have the series, the whole of it. That's awesome. Yes, go
well,
on.
We'll figure out fusion by working with Beast-O-Matics.
Yes. I've already deposited my dollar in a compound interest rated bank, so I will get there by the end of the year. I want to eat the cow invites me to eat it.
Yeah, I rush into the kitchen to kill myself.
That is the most pure, un-vegan thing you can send to them. I did that this week.
It's a bit like a feminist meeting a Muslim, yeah. Right? I'm just gonna rush to the kitchen and rape myself.
Yep. Oh god! I sent who made the Charming Man made a video about veganism or something, and then I was on a conversation with someone, quote unquote, and I sent them the video of the actual thing saying, "Oh, please have something off my shoulder," with a beautiful Cockney, it was a slight Cockney accent that.
Well, you've, what was it? Father's Day. My boss invited me over to his house, and he was smoking out a whole rack, like several racks of ribs and all this stuff. I just kept tweeting it to Peter, which by the way, then this isn't even a joke. I mean, it's a total joke, but it's actually a real thing. Apparently Peter is reaching out to, game creators and such. They reached out to Warhammer 40K. They want them to stop. They want them to stop creating characters who wear fur.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
We were talking. Me, Bene, and Omegon were talking about that before the stream started. There, and I pointed out that they absolutely are so muted, silent about halal slaughter.
Oh yeah,
are they?
That,
well, I mean, they're
against it, no?
In Canada, they actually celebrate it.
Well, isn't halal slaughter just like, I mean, kosher is like it's a series of guidelines on what Manati.
Same thing, basically.
Yeah, well, no, but I mean, I've been told at least, and I could be wrong, but I've been told that halal effectively just means like don't eat certain things, but anything that's halal.
No. You have halal slaughter of animals. You get someone who's an officiated quote unquote minister. He faces east or towards Mecca. He says Allah Akbar, or God is great, or blessed, whatever. Then they slit the throat of the living, live, unstunned animal. Till it bleeds to death, it cuts the throat.
Oh, so they let it die, filled with stress hormones.
Wonderful. Makes the meat better.
Well, it makes the meat. You know, it makes it last longer because you have to chew it forever.
It's there. That is okay, but if you humanely stun the animal so it does not feel pain, that is totally PETA-inspired outrage.
That's kind of funny, then, that, like, in a sense, that killer Shugar from No Country for Old Men was more humane than these halal butchers.
Of course, yeah. Don't get me wrong. We have not now, because of European regulations, EU regulations. But I remember when I was a kid, basically killing their porks that way, basically stabbing the heart. It was in three seconds, it was dead. The way they did it, the good. Yeah. But in halal, they hang them up by the cows, and all of them, they hang them up by one of the legs, the back legs, and they cut it, the throat, and they just keep going. Suit has made a videos about that shit. Suit himself. Mm-hmm. Australian blogger, his video. Fuck, it's horrific. We were humane, even in our traditional methods, going back to eons. And but PETA still remains fucking silent. There's no protest, and I know why. Because the Muslims would fucking start chopping them up.
John,
and look, racist, God forbid.
Yeah, that's probably what they're worried about. I mean, being chopped up, as long as it's not an animal being chopped up, then.
Yeah, exactly. They're cowards, basically. Pets is cowards.
Oh, Peter's fucking retarded. I mean, I try and troll Peter whenever I can. Like, anytime I've got a lovely plate of meat, I'll just be like, this, you know, it's wintertime. This animal's nice and warm. Keep in mind, these are people who tried running a campaign to get they wanted to start calling what was it? What did they want to call sea kittens? Oh, yeah, they just want to call fish sea kittens. So it's
yeah.
Like, I'm sorry.
I know that one.
That sounds like it was
by 4chan. Yeah, it was an honest campaign. This is the thing, is like he was one of those first like real activist groups who really brought their activism to such a retarded place that it was the first like Poe or retard game. Is this a Poe or a retard? Oh, it's PETA. Well, it's definitely a retard then. Is it the real PETA? Oh, it's verified. Yep, that's retarded.
It's retarded.
Not just making a joke.
They are I'm fine with vegetarians. I even love vegetarian dish. I even cook it myself and all that shit. But it's the vegans I have problems. And last year, I've disconnected myself from these two. They called me a murderer, rapist, genocidist for me eating beef. I said, of course. What?
Genocide.
Genocide.
Did you fuck the cow?
No, I ate the nice steak from the cow.
So it's eating. Yeah. Interesting how many definitions of rape we have these days.
Oh, yeah. Fuck. I'm a rapist. I'm a genocidal rapist murderer for eating meat.
Yeah,
they still haven't blocked me, though.
Oh, they blocked me after the barbecue. I'll tell you that, man.
I'm not talking about Peter.
All day with my phone. I like once my boss gave me his like home Wi-Fi login, all day I just periodically, because you know you got to smoke those ribs for like, you know, fucking seven hours. They just went and went. So like all day I was just taking pictures of those and the pork belly. And the fuck, yeah. I'm getting really hungry thinking about this. But yeah, I kept tweeting pictures of it to them like all day. And then when I got home, I got on my computer. I'm like, oh, I'm finally blocked by PETA. Good for me.
Of course, man. Ribs, the meat has to just slide off the bone. It has to be so tender. Oh, God, I'm hungry now.
Yeah.
I love food.
I love food. I love like food that is flesh. I love food that like it's funny actually. Like I have a house guest, sort of housemate right now, a lady friend of mine. She's a vegetarian. Still no compunction about eating eggs. So I don't really that's not even a vegetarian at that point. And I told her the other day, she's like, I'm like, you're really bad vegetarian. She's like, I've heard that before from some vegetarians. I hear it from every vegan, though.
Ovo-lacto vegetarian, eating eggs.
She doesn't eat fish, though. That's the weird thing. I've heard of pescatarians. I love how we went from the end of the world to veganism. It's almost like we're trying to make ourselves feel better if the world ends. We're like, well, at least those fucking people will be gone.
Go with us, yeah. Well, they are one of the causes for possible end of the world.
Yeah, well, no, I mean, like, honestly, if I had the nuclear codes, every time I saw one of those billboards with some, like, fucking hipster backyard farmer hugging a chicken and it's saying they can be better friends than food, I'd fucking mash that goddamn button just like I'd mash the goddamn gas pedal if I found a Black Lives Matter protest on I-93. It's like, smash.
Exactly. We don't have, thank goodness we don't have that shit here, because I raise chickens, well, fowl, so we can have dinner. And I tell you, I can't now eat supermarket bought fowls. I just can't. They just don't taste the same. I'm too spoilt for quality.
Oh, yeah, no, I used to live, before I moved down here to Manchester, I used to live in the country with my brother, and there was like this, it was a supermarket, well, no, it wasn't a supermarket, it was just a market shop, decent sized one, but they had, like, all of their meats were, like, locally sourced, and this is the thing that, like, these anti-GMO, eat organic flakes really need to get on, it's that I don't give a fuck what parts of the world I'm helping save by buying better meat. point out to me, you know, if you want to convince me to like eat better meat, you know, give me the Pepsi challenge. Because the other night I bought a fucking steak at the supermarket. My God, it was bad. It was tasteless. It was like damp cardboard, basically.
With the butchers which I frequent, I have a good test if they're good or not. It's the ground meat, the ground beef that they have to make burgers, ragu, whatever.
Mincemeat.
I buy from a supermarket, from another major supermarket. It's a French. What's it called? Jesus, the three. It's like the Musketeers. Yeah, I'm sure you have it in Ireland as well, don't you, Raven?
I don't know which one do you mean, the Musketeers? Oh,
God, yeah.
I don't know.
Never mind. It'll come back to me. It's just the name's blocked. I'm shit at names. I know stuff anyway, but I'm shit at names. There, I buy it at a local butcher, and I also buy another butcher in Spain because I live close to Spain. And I know it's good quality because when I buy the ground beef, when I put it in the pan or the thing, and it doesn't
shrink.
It doesn't shrink. It doesn't ooze out grease, but it oozes out water. If it oozes out, not water, you know, the juices, then I know it's fucking perfect. And that's how I know it's a good cut of beef. But here, our beefs are fucking transparent. They don't know how to cut them. So that's the bad part. So, yeah. Nothing's perfect.
They're crunchy, is it? When you say transparent.
They cut them really thin. The beefs, they cut them really thin. And it's weird cuts. It's the ribeye, for example, they don't cut it as it should. They cut it across the grain, which is just...
That's stupid.
The T-bones, they cut them too thin. Instead of leaving a space either side, they put it right up, and they use the fucking bones you just cut, and the bones aren't that thick. The best ones that they do have is what we call the chuleton. It's a fucking kilogram of beef, T-bone type steak. They do cut that well, and the Brazilian.
What I really dislike is when the Irish, some of the butchers, they just cut off all the fat and throw it away. That's the best bit.
You have to leave a little. I always leave a little. Yeah, a little bit. Just a little. You know what I mean.
It also comes down to how you cook it. I mean, like I like if I'm gonna like I like to broil my steak, right? And I need, you need that fat because I mean that. Yeah. That needs to crisp up and get good and like sort of, you know, brownish orange,
mm-hmm.
a little singed, and it gives you that crisp crunch. Yeah, and it's a little flavor.
Yeah, the
flavor. My steaks have to be basically grilled over a fire. I'm waiting for summer because I'm planning to fucking barbecue every fucking single day. I have my. We've gone well. We're now talking about food. When we talk about food, it's the best conversation anyone can have.
Fuck you. I manage to eat once a day, and I have yet to reach that point in the day. So,
You know what I mean. The people who enjoy food are good people.
Yeah, I used to actually. But here's an interesting thing. I actually one time cooked for Samuel L. Jackson.
Nice.
Yeah, no, I used to work in, like, I used to be a cook, and like I had a couple jobs in which they told me I was a chef, like a chef de cuisine, which is basically just line cook. That's all it is. I was a line cook. Yeah. But they said, you're a chef, come up with specials and shit. But I was working this one catering gig at this restaurant, and we were catering a wedding of this big, rich, well-to-do fucker out who like had a, you know, like he lived in New Hampshire as one of his, like it was like his summer home or something, big fancy estate with a carriage house and shit. And so we set a whole mobile kitchen up in the carriage house, and So, like, there was, like, two senators and, like, three congresspeople there. Samuel L. Jackson and Alfre Woodard were both there. And I was put in charge of making these hors d'oeuvres, which were, they were large prawn. And so they were cooked over cedar chips. And then I made a mango mango relish. And really the whole dish was take these prawn, stick them on the end of a fork, put a gob of mango relish on the back of the fork, behind the on top and behind the prawn, and that's the dish. And the waitresses would take them out like eight at a time. And I guess Samuel L. Jackson was just eating them like two at a time, like just double fisting these things. Like Samuel L. Jackson all the prawn. Okay, I guess we'll make more. That's fine. I'm okay with this. But yeah, I mean, that's the really the food is the only thing I miss about the restaurant world. Like cooking. I don't know. Is anyone else who cooked professionally?
Nope.
Fucking miserable. I mean, like, you see the Gordon Ramsay shit. That's like half of the kitchens I worked in.
I plan to when I retire.
How did you get that? How did you get that gig, Nick? Hmm? I mean, were you looking for a job as an actor when you were cooking?
No. This is my first line of work. I started out like my first job when I was 15. I was a dishwasher, and when that was a dishwasher. You dishwasher in a restaurant, and then eventually, like you graduate and you become a prep cook. So you're like prepping all the food. And then after that, you get on the line. And I work, restaurants have high turnover. So you just keep working restaurant after restaurant. And when you're hard up for work, even if you leave the industry and you go and get a new profession and you lose your job there, right? Or if you're between jobs somehow and you need money, like you go find a restaurant to work at because they're almost always hiring cooks. And sometimes you'll walk into a restaurant that's, let's say, above your skill level, but they'll take you on because they'll just say, fuck it, we'll just teach you how to do this shit. And let me see, the last place I worked, if you were working like float shift or closing, which usually meant you came in before lunch and then closed through dinner. But if you showed up then, you had to come up with a special. And most people like were really into it, so they'd come up with their special ahead of time. I just show up and throw something together. One time I came in and I'm like, fuck, I gotta do a special. Okay. We've got some leftover Thanksgiving style stuffing from whatever the fuck that was about. We've got some lobster meat and we've got mushroom caps.
Ooh, lobster.
Yep. Yeah, I did lobster stuff, mushroom. Did a little oil and Parmesan on the top and then just oven baked them, plated them six to a plate. The manager and the owner freaked out because I'd already prepped them by the time they knew what I was doing. Like, I'd prepped an entire... I'd prepped, like, three, four trays of these things, right? And they freaked out because they did the numbers, and they're like, we're gonna need to run these things at, like, $12, $14 a plate. No one's going to fucking buy these at six a plate. Oh. And they sold out before lunch was over.
Shit. Yeah, I know what it is to work in a restaurant, not from my experience, but from my wife's experience. She was a dishwasher in a local restaurant here. Mm-hmm. She stayed for a year, and she worked from 10 in the morning to 1 in the morning next day.
Wow.
And a half an hour break.
Yep. Yeah, that's about it for a dishwasher because you're paid the least. I mean,
exactly.
Yeah, it's minimum wage gig.
She's now back into her first job, basically working in the camping sites, camping grounds, local camping grounds. It's okay. She's doing part time, so tomorrow she's going to work from 9 to 1 p.m. and the rest of the day is off because it's a low season. At the high season, she starts at 9 to about 7, 6, 7.
Yep. It's fucking nice. Yeah. I mean, the last restaurant I worked in was a place called the Barley House. And this place was cool because you had the main kitchen upstairs, and then we had a prep kitchen downstairs. And it was known for its burgers. And the thing is, if you go into the Barley House in Concord and you order a burger, that burger was cut off of a shoulder that was delivered that morning and ground in-house. We did a lot of our own, all of the prep, everything was fresh, everything we knew where it came from. And I got to say, like, the restaurant itself, like, the worst part about it was the management. Like, the kitchen manager had this, like, he was, you know, people joke that, you know, people like to joke about my alcoholism, my drinking and all this. This kid was a true dyed-in-the-wool alcoholic, like, could not go without a drink. And then his bitch girlfriend, and I say bitch girlfriend not for this, but just because she was a cunt in general, made him quit. And so, what is it? He comes up, like, we're running the line. We've got three people on the line. We're getting the orders out. He's just wandering around sort of aimlessly. He comes up on the line and decides he's going to start doing this and that. And so, while he's standing in this place, I'm, like, having to reach around him to get ingredients. He's like, if you reach around me like that one more time, I'm going to stab you. And I'm just, like, in the middle of a rush. And I just stopped everything I was doing. I grabbed one of the big knives off the fucking, off the magnet rack along the wall. I just pointed in his fucking face. I'm like, if you ever say that to someone, make sure you have a fucking knife in your hand, you cunt. Get off my line.
Fucking awesome, man.
Yeah.
Oh, I can't top that.
Well, I mean, that's the kind of shit you get in restaurants, dude. I mean, it's funny, too, because, like, when I worked, I used to work at a... We had a chain in here in the States called Ruby Tuesdays. Basically, like, I'm sure you're familiar with what Applebee's is.
It's like yes, I know Applebee's. Yeah.
Ruby Tuesdays was basically the same thing. I think they're still around someplace, but... Well, Arby's is fast food. Ruby Tuesdays, it's called fast casual. Mm-hmm. But, when I was working there, a number of the cooks, they made a bong out of... It was the most ingenious thing. They took a cucumber and they cut one end off and then they drilled down almost to the bottom and then they drilled in the side, yeah. Okay. And they took a baby carrot and they they hollowed it out to make a slide and they carved it nicely. And we were just packed. We were like, you know, we all took the garbage out together. So I go out with them and we're just hitting this thing and it bubbled and it tasted like, you know, it tasted like cucumber. It was so clean and crisp. It was the best little homemade box. And we're out there.
You can destroy the evidence afterwards.
Well, the general manager comes out and like, he knows what we're doing. But the thing is, he comes out and like, I hide the thing behind my back. And he's like, we're just standing there. And he's like, all right, I know you guys are fucking smoking and joking out here. That's fine. We're kind of slow. When you get back in, I want you to get the grout done on the floors. I want you to get the fryers cleaned out. I want your dish done. And I want us to get ready to close, okay? And everyone's like, yep. And like, I was a dish dog at the time. And I'm standing there, like, hands behind my back. And I've got this bong behind my back. And I've still got a hit in my lungs. He's like, yep. And I'm like... And he's like, yeah. I'm like, yep. A little whiff of smoke comes out of my mouth. He's like, looks at me. He's like, looks at all of us like, fuck you guys. God, fuck all of you. Just goes back inside. He's like, don't be out here too long.
Oh, God. He was an understanding.
You don't last in restaurant management if you're not understanding. You don't.
Exactly. Yeah.
I mean, shit, there was one manager. We had a cook. I worked at a place called Bertucci's. It was an Italian joint in a brick oven, wood-fired pizzeria, which there's no other way. Oh, I used to love working the oven because I'd just go up to the ingredient line when it was slow. I'd just throw random shit into a piece of dough, wrap it up like into a ball, put it in tinfoil, and just stick it like in the back of the oven. And then like 40 minutes later, when it was slow again, I'd just pull it out and that's my snack. But we had this cook who was one of the old waitress's sons, and he was just an absolute cunt. Shit at his job, shitty attitude, everything. Kitchen manager Bobby, who I'm pretty sure did a lot of coke. Most of them do. Well, Bobby wants this kid gone, but he can't just fire him, you know? So, yes, I know. It's funny, Tony, a Jew working the ovens. But So he comes up and he's like, all right. He's like, we got to get the fuck rid of him today. I'm like, how do you want me to do it? He's like, just fucking ride him like a horse, dude. I'm like, okay. He's like, I want tears. I want tears today. Okay. Like, you got it. So I just went about it like I was the worst kitchen manager ever. I wasn't even in management, but like everything the kid did was wrong in my eyes. And I let him know everything was wrong. Like, he tried to fight me twice before he quit. And then when he finally quit, he like threw his apron down and stormed off. And Bobby comes up and like just like gives me this hug, and he's like, "Good job, come with me." And he grabs these two little paper cone, like the cone paper cups from the water cooler,
Mm-hmm.
He uses his manager's key to open up the liquor cabinet, like the liquor's locker. And he just cracks this bottle of Wild Turkey. Keep in mind, this is a corporate restaurant, so we're accountable for everything there. But Bobby just doesn't give a fuck. He's just so happy. He cracks this bottle of Wild Turkey, pours us each a shot, says, yeah, all right, let's do another one. Yeah, all right, one more. Yeah, three shots of Wild Turkey. He's like, all right, get back to work. We're short of cook now.
So that's how you started cooking, Nick.
Oh yeah, you start in the dish pit and you work up to prep, and then eventually somebody trains you on the line, and you start basic short order fry shit, and you learn the grill, and you just learn how a kitchen works. And then when you get to a real restaurant, usually like a privately owned one, like that doesn't have like the corporate menu and shit, that's when they have real chefs working there, and then the chefs teach you. Like you will never really find a top-notch five-star chef who started out by going to culinary school.
Mm-hmm. No. That's true. You have to learn. You have to have the passion. I know that if I ever survive to retirement, I will have no pension. So I want to start a
bistro
truck, a food truck.
Making food, it's not the kind of thing you go to school for. It's an artisanal trade.
It's an artisanal, exactly.
Wow. Yeah, it's an artisanal trade.
But yeah, I hope to make a sort of a slight gourmet fish and chips takeaway food truck.
Yeah.
And instead of just standard cod and whiting and all that shit, sometimes have some salmon, some other.
Yeah, you know, I mean, so, yeah. Yeah, well, you take the cod even too. You take the cod, yeah. You hit it with some lime and some curry powder, perhaps. Put some
yeah, chili. Beer batter.
Yeah. Oh, chili in the beer batter. For the beer batter, use like Guinness or a nice stout for the batter too. You throw your spices in with the batter, and then when you fry that, you pull it out.
Yep.
And then you could even actually, just not even fish and chips, you know what you do? You do fish and chip tacos with self-made masa.
I've thought of that, but no, I'm going to keep it very, very simple, because that way I can get maximum profit, maximum speed, restrict my selection to a two type of fish plus one burger, cheeseburger, that's it. A traditional American cheeseburger, nice big patty,
ground beef,
slider, ground beef, nice cheese on top, and that's it. Maybe some caramelized onions, but that's it. Nothing else.
Well, you know about coffee and cinnamon in your burger, right?
Of course, yeah, I know, yeah, I know, yeah, all I know all of it, yeah.
No.
To me, the American cheeseburger is the epitome of the top. The crowning glory of a burger.
Well, no, listen, I reviewed this. It's funny. I actually got paid by Every Joe to review it after I ate it. I took a friend of mine. She was up for the weekend from D.C. And we went to this local place called the Red Arrow. It's a nationally known diner. And they have, it used to be called the Newton Burger, named not after the scientist, but the town of Newton.
But the town.
Mm. Now it's called the Trump Tower Burger. And the Trump, let me tell you what the Trump Tower Burger is. It's a hand-pressed half-pound beef patty. Whoa. That on top of it is a patty of fried mac and cheese. Atop that is cheese sauce, and the buns for this monstrosity are two grilled cheese sandwiches.
Oh, shit.
In fact, you know what? Hold on. I will show you. Every Joe. By the way, anyone who wants to read the reviews of this or all kinds of beer, you just go to everyjoe.com and look for Nicholas Goroff, and you'll find the beer and review. I'm maybe the best writer there. I can't say. It's not for me to say. It's for you to say.
You are. I read them. Yes.
I'm pretty sure I'm the most like regular contributor there, but yeah, here it is.
Okay,
I'm gonna link it to you in the side chat.
Yep, I'll add it to the link afterwards. I'll do it now because in case I forget. Side chat. Yeah, I'll put it in the link in.
I lost the side chat.
What? It's that green. No, the blue top thing. Chat in your.
Oh, there it is. Yeah,
there it is. Yeah. The blues. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, that. I mean, just go there and look at the picture, though. Look at that fucking image. And I mean, screen share it if you want, because I think the people deserve
it. Oh, we're going to do it now. Yeah, you're going to do it. We're going to screen share. This thing It'll be me fun. First. Okay, we're screen sharing.
Of course, I shill myself. That's what I do.
That's the one. There we go.
Yeah, look at that thing. And that's after
that is awesome.
Yeah, that's after I kind of tucked into it. But it hurts.
But it in terms of sandwiches, Portugal has the best sandwich in the world, and I will not accept you. I've extended an invitation to you to come over to my area where I live, Nick.
No, I will.
It's open. I will feast. I will get you the best. This. Sandwich. Find a good one because they're not all the same. The secret is in the sauce.
The secret of the sauce is like whether or not you stroke with a right or left hand.
The secret is the sauce. Here is a hot, if you guys can see it, here's the selection of them, and that's basically what it is. It's
what the fuck? That looks like some kind of fucking pancake French dip where it's like you don't dip it. No, we dip it for you. We just cover the sauce.
It has a steak. It has a local sausage we call linguiça. It has lots of cheese. It has what's the other one? Cheese. It has bacon. Bacon, yeah, it has bacon. It has ham,
fried egg.
It's on a bread, then cheese on top, and it goes into the oven. The cheese melts, and then you add the sauce. The sauce is a tomato sauce based with beer, brandy, champagne, and a whole lot of spices. It has to be just that little bit hot.
My resident vegetarian is looking very sardonically at my screen at the moment. I can't tell if she's judging harshly or if she's just wishing that she could eat something like this.
I ate one last month that I've in a local city, I can tell you it is.
This is why Portugal doesn't have nearly any real military anymore. Is because everyone dies of coronary, coronary disease before they reach the age of enlistment.
I thought that was Ireland.
We lost our good military because we lost the draft.
Yeah, you lost the slave trade, and then all of a sudden you couldn't get the healthy-bodied Negroes out of Africa anymore. I know, you kept the best ones for yourself. Everyone knows that.
Of course that. We started the transatlantic slave trade. So yeah, I'm not gonna apologize for my ancestors. Fuck, they were the best then.
This reference to slave trade was brought to you by the nation of Kekistan,
of Angola and Guinea.
No, fuck Kekistan. No, we're talking Angola.
Angola. So yeah, it was
slaves. There are no slaves in Kekistan.
Nope. There are only slaves now in Qatar. Well, Qatar, India, Afghanistan, the Middle East.
Well, they're slaves, but they're slaves of peace. So don't worry about
it. Exactly. No, I don't. I don't. If Steve Shives doesn't, why should I?
Yeah, exactly. No, I mean, like, there's the thing. It's like, you know, when you see those videos of, like, you know, the Saudis beating women half to death because they maybe like showed an eyelash out of place. That's domestic violence of peace right there.
No, it's not. It's cultural enrichment.
Exactly. They're being enriched culturally.
Yeah,
fists.
I plan I plan, if I ever go visit back to Australia, I plan to identify as a Muslim.
Back to Australia.
Back to Australia.
Back to Australia.
Because if I identify as a Muslim and any woman approaches me, I will be offended and she will be taken away and arrested.
Oh, so, okay, so this is something I didn't know about him. So, like, when you travel, you're like, your deepest desire is to make sure that you keep women as far away from you as possible. Okay.
Exactly. Only my wife is allowed, but everyone, if those stupid screeching feminists come near me, I will be offended and I'll have them arrested because they are I'm a Muslim.
And Portugal is like America in the 1950s, where like you keep a wife to like keep people from calling you a confirmed bachelor. Okay, it's all making sense.
Oh, sweetheart, I'm not fluid.
You do a bit of Milo impression. I'm honestly, like, you know, if you, these days, if you want to be a dangerous faggot in the U.S., all you have to do is, you know, I don't know, start a foundation that you'll never actually pay out on.
Shit. Oh, God, I wish I was less honest than I am. I really have so many scams running in my head, but I can't get them running because I'm just too honest. I'd start a religion. I start an NGO. I can start a movement or all that shit. But I can't because I'm too honest. And shit happens.
Well, I'm going, unless there's anything pressing to talk about, I'm going to have to get to work.
Man, it was awesome having you on. Thank you, man. I'm also going to end this stream. It's close
Make
by.
Make sure you move the clock forward, Nick.
No, you know what? You know what? I'm like, how, if it wasn't for the fact that, like, I don't know, did any of you catch my most recent video?
I
fucking sorted out the whole background issue. That is literally just a bed skirt with two stage. My buddy came over with these two stage lights. He's a gigging musician, like the big can lights. Yeah, he fucking mounted these things into the little cubby that I use for for my videos. And I just splash that light on them, and all of a sudden it looks like I'm on a big think set. It's great. So,
well, the one that I saw had a white background. Was that the one?
Yeah, the last one, the white background.
The Twitter questions.
But just with that, it was just like, oh boy. And then I'm like, oh, and now I get to test out this blue Yeti mic here on on your. So congratulations, man! You're hosting me and my new technology.
Oh, thank you.
I've been drinking rum, so I forgot where I was really going with that. So I just kind of tied it up.
I'm still finishing a Franciscana Weiss beer. So yeah.
Oh, nice.
I have to drive 50 fucking kilometers to get this.
Can you get Julius Hector where you are?
No, man, I'm limited to Franciscana.
Guinness is good. Guinness, it's owned by Heineken.
Yeah, Guinness export when they have it. Duvel, here we go. Duvel Golden, Belgian Golden Ale, and a few other beers. Delirium Tremors. I don't know where the fuck that comes from.
That's from Belgium.
Yeah, it's very, very hopsy.
I get a lot of people coming in asking for, like, do you have Delirium here? Like, no. We live in New Hampshire. We don't get good beer here.
So, yeah, I have to drive a hell of a lot to get the good stuff, or else I just buy the Portuguese Super Bock, which is not fucking bad. It's quite good.
Yeah, Bock is good.
Okay.
All right, I'm going to fuck off. It was good talking to you all. Chat.
Same here, man. I'm going to also end. Thank you, Chad. Thank you, everyone. And good night.